Hi, everybody. Welcome to another edition of the Hangouts on Air for Front End Nano Degree. Today I'm joined with Mike Wales, and I'm Jonathan Mavrudis. Today we're going to be talking about Project 3, which Mike Wales actually put together for everybody, and we hope you've been enjoying it so far. We wanted to talk a little bit about like our expectations and sort of what the minimum requirements for the project are. Mm-hmm. So as you can see here, when we load up the game, we have our little player character starting in the middle of the grass. I mean, he can realistically kind of start anywhere. He can
start anywhere, yeah.
Yeah. So the minimum requirements we usually ask for is first of all that, right, the little guy can move around. This is using the direction mm-hmm. keys. And that functionality is pretty much already built in.
The key handling is already put in. You just have to kind of watch for the key handling and adjust the data of your player mm-hmm. so that whenever it draws in the new position.
Yeah. Our player should be sort of confined in that window.
Right.
So if I kind of move my player, I can't go any further right even though I'm mashing right, and I can't go any further left even though I'm mashing left. And if he happens to fall off the window, then he's kind of not on the game anymore.
Right.
So we want to try and avoid things like this where the player can just sort of step out of bounds.
Right.
And then the second thing is that the bugs move across the screen.
Mm-hmm.
So here we got a bunch of bugs flying across the screen at different speeds. And these are the vehicles.
The bad guys.
Yeah, the bad guys that we got to try and avoid. So we can see that there's just this constant stream of bugs. So let's kind of recap those three things real quick. Player moves, bugs move, and player doesn't fall off the screen.
Mm-hmm.
The fourth piece of functionality we're looking for, which you probably just saw. is if I happen to get hit by one of these bugs, see here, oh no, I fall all the way back to the beginning.
Yep.
The last little piece of functionality is sort of winning the game in a sense, and that's if I'm able to get all the way across the road. And again, all right, let me not hit anything here. When I get across, it resets the game as well.
Which is acceptable. You can go as crazy as you want with this project. This is the minimum viable passing project.
So then the next thing we have is sort of the criteria called object-oriented code. Let's talk a little bit about that. So the whole course this is built off of is the object-oriented JavaScript course. Can we go into a little detail about what we mean by object-oriented and sort of how that differs from maybe some of the programming people are familiar with?
Yeah, so object-oriented programming, particularly in JavaScript, is whenever you write what we call a class. And so in JavaScript, we really don't have classes, but we kind of fake it.
Mm-hmm.
A class in JavaScript is any structure that can create a fleet of objects that are similar in nature. So your bugs, for instance, you have three different bugs. There's really no point in like having to write this out three different times.
Mm-hmm.
You just create the general structure that defines a bug, and then you instantiate that object a few times. One of the biggest things we're looking for is using the prototype object correctly. You don't want to define your render and update functions on every single object that's on the screen. You want that type of functionality to be on the class that mm-hmm. instantiates the objects.
So then the last three sections in the rubric I think should be pretty straightforward. Code quality, we're just asking that you kind of adhere to the style guide we provide you.
Mm-hmm.
You format your code. It's easy to read. I think that's sort of the biggest point, is that if you were to give this to your mom who doesn't know any JavaScript, she'd at least be able to look at it and like be able to point out
lines. Yeah.
Say like, oh, this makes sense.
Yeah, just be consistent. We've had some questions regarding like spaces. Do mm-hmm. I use four spaces, two spaces? Do I use tabs? Just be consistent with your spacing and the way you lay things out. And like you said, we want it to be readable by our coaches and not just like one line string of symbols.
Mm. So. Then the next one is comments. I think comments should be pretty common practice in any sort of programming you do.
Mm-hmm.
Even with HTML, like leaving comments in and just say like, oh, this is what sort of this section is for. Comments are just sort of a programmer-to-programmer way of communicating.
Exactly. So you don't want to have a comment that says, like, draw the bug. Because it's pretty obvious that line is drawing the bug. Comments are really good for answering the question of why am I doing something this mm-hmm. way. It really is programmer-to-programmer talk. 10 years down the road, when you move on to a new company and some guy takes over your application, you want to leave enough comments that he doesn't want to track you down and kill you.
Yeah. the last one, documentation, where we ask the students to provide us a README file, I'd say that's more just so you get into the habit of writing sort of a README. Write this as if you were, you know, sending this game to a friend and you wanted to be able to show it to them.
Yeah.
And especially if you like really go above and beyond, kind of really make this game your own, a little bit of a README of some of the additions you added, how you did them, that would all be really, really great. I mean, as documented as you can make your project, the better it's going to look.
Yeah.